Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to a new campaign. I'm hesitant to call it a campaign, but welcome to a new show on Charisma to AC. We'll be playing The Burning Wheel. This is a first for all of us. So, yeah.
Popping the cherry.
Exactly. This is our virgin attempt at The Burning Wheel. I've heard a lot about this game. I've had a look into this game, and we have had a tinkering first touch on the mechanics of the game, but we've never played it, and we've never really experienced it as such. So, yeah, welcome to the show. And joining me for this show is people you know from A Song of Tara. But just in case you haven't watched that show, allow me to briefly introduce who we have here. We have with us Aya, we have Rasmus, we have Chris, and joining us later on in the evening, we'll have Heinem. Hello, guys. How are you doing?
Hi.
Hello. I think, I speak for myself on this. I'm doing fairly well on this balmy Sunday evening.
That's good.
Yes, I agree with the weird guy.
It's a tiny bit too hot for my liking right now.
That's because you live in Denmark, which apparently has the strange condition of having no natural breeze of any kind in summer.
Well, right. It has been windy for the last couple of days, but there's no wind today, and it's humid and that's annoying, and there's thunder in the air.
Yeah, that's I want problem. Thunder.
It's overcast as fuck, and the humidity is just insane and annoying and bad.
Humidity is always bad.
Yeah.
At least when it comes to the weather being too hot.
Mm-hmm.
So, let's talk about what this actually is, right? So, for those of you who don't know, Burning Wheel is, I'm hesitant to call it a recent game because it's not really that recent, but it is definitely a younger game, than, Vampire or Werewolf or Dungeons and Dragons or Pathfinder. Burning Wheel is it's a game made by a dude named Luke Crane, and it is, after having briefly read through the book, is contender for my favorite role-playing game of all time, and I have yet to even fucking play it. I really like a lot of the stuff they did with this game, and I hope that we'll find out as we play that the game plays as well as it's written. So this episode will be a world-building session. We'll be doing some expectation management. We'll be talking about the setting because we don't have a pre-prepared setting for this. So we will be creating the world we mean to play in, and not necessarily the entirety of the place, because we might want to use the spiral technique of just, you know, starting at a center point and then moving outwards as we need stuff, which means that we can also build parts of the world as we play. But right now we'll be wanting to build a framework we can work within and build enough of an understanding for ourselves that we can make characters within the space and fill out details as we move forward. So, yeah. So, brief introduction, I guess. For those of you who don't know out there in the viewing audience, and for you guys too, who's joining me for this wonderful game. This game uses D6s exclusively. Most of the dice rolling will be handled via your character sheets. I have made a character sheet for all of you in the journal. I think, Chris, you won't be able to see yours just yet. But I'll just make sure that you can.
I think I see Chris's character.
Wonderful. Yep, that's exactly right. So, there you go. You should be able to... you should be able to work with your character sheets now.
Yes, I can.
All right. So, I mean, before we start going into how do we create a character and how do we do anything in this game, how to game, I'm thinking we want to talk about the world in which we try to come up with concepts for our characters, and what sort of game we want to play. Because this game can be... We can play a game about a lot of things, but sometimes having an awareness of like the tone of what we want to play is very useful for making this sort of things up. So do any of you have like a preference for what would you like to play with Burning Wheel as the vehicle?
Fantasy.
Point taken. Yeah, this game does fantasy. It doesn't do non-fantasy particularly well. At least not...
well, that's, I felt like it was important.
Yeah, you know, it's a good point. But yeah, the game is written... the book that I have in front of me, which is Burning Wheel Gold, is written from the assumption that... or is written to suit a Tolkien-esque world mixed with real medieval-esque setting.
Medieval-esque?
Yeah. Combining... It's set in fantasy. You could also set it in just... You could set it in non-fantasy, strictly speaking. Like, the game is open enough that we could just have it be medieval roleplay, but we could also include as many high or dark fantasy elements as we wanted to. It is written from the presumption that the highest, quote-unquote, highest level of modern technological development is the recent introduction of gunpowder weaponry.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we don't have to go that far. We can exclude it. That will mean that certain life paths and certain skills obtained from those life paths will have to be omitted or changed. But we'll get into that when we start making characters. So, okay, we want to play some fantasy. I'm not hearing any objections to that, and I can't imagine anyone would, because this is kind of what we're here for. But...
Are you sure?
I'm thinking more on that. If we want to get a bit further into it, what do we actually want to play? Like, do we have any ideas for... Do we want a classical heroes overcoming the great odds and slaying the evil wizard story? Or are we more into... like, what are the elements we want to compose this campaign of?
In that regard, I'm much more open.
How open are you?
I'm interested...
Go to see open.
I personally would like to see how heroes... like us would interact with a grand scale situation rather than us going for... I mean, you can have the grand thing of a single enemy, a single evil wizard in his dark ebony tower, and we go in and defeat him with MacGuffin of awesomeness. But there's a dog outside. Okay. Anyway, yes. But no, I was thinking more, how would we respond in a much bigger thing where there's no one single enemy? Like, how would we... operate in a large war between nations, for example? Where would we stand with that? Would we act independent? Would we choose sides? Would we get involved in conflict on battlefields and sieges? Would we be used as like assassins? Could we rouse populaces or things like that? That would be my personal interest.
Yeah.
So caught in the maelstrom kind of thing?
Possibly, or even exacerbate it if you want to. We could be agents of chaos.
Yeah, I
see. Well, that sounds interesting.
Go on, AJ, you had a point.
Exacerbated sounded very kinky. I have no idea what it actually means, but it sounds kinky.
It just means to sort of make it worse, or to at least to make it
less good.
Bigger. When people say they exacerbate the problem, it means they're making the problem worse, basically.
Okay, that could be cool.
Yeah, I can see us playing a game of like, we want there to be a conflict, but we don't want necessarily to be the classic Dungeons and Dragons-esque fantasy trope of there being an off switch for the problem, which is
like,
kill the evil
no.
wizard, or throw the ring into Mount Doom and just everything will be good and we will have, you know, white bread and honey and milk for days. So, yeah, if we want a more, like, maybe a big issue, but on a, like, we introduce the complications that would arise from like, larger issues and have you work within or without that framework as your characters would either prefer or as circumstances may dictate, be made to.
I think that sounds interesting.
Yeah. I think we also want to, when we talk about this, consider the scope of this particular campaign we're running right now, or we mean to run. None of us having actually played the game before, and me only having the cursory knowledge of having read the book and not really employed it in any sense. This game is a bit complicated, and it has the capacity for being very simple, and it has the options of getting very complicated when you want to deal with the tighter nitty gritty of how do we want to make something work? How do we want to play a scene out? We can get as complicated as we want to within the scope of the game itself. But with that in mind, we also want to be aware of the time, right? How long do we mean to play this for? How long of a shot are we going to give this game? And that will, in a way, mean that we won't, for example, be making like a great arc that would require us to play 30 to 60 sessions of Burning Wheel in order to do it any kind of justice.
Well, it's my experience that our group isn't very good with short campaigns, but not necessarily with overly long either. So somewhere in the middle, preferably closer to long than short. It's my input.
I think maybe we also, because we don't have, this is for you guys, but this is also for the viewing audience. We don't have a set time slot for running these things, which means we'll be running these games whenever we have the time, whenever the option arises, whenever the planets align and we all have a free moment at, like, we have three free hours, at the same time, we'll be sitting down and playing some Burning Wheel. Which of course also means that there won't be regular intervals between the episode, right? They'll go up randomly as we get to play them. But I think there's something to what Rasmus said. I'm thinking maybe we do a setup in which we can work with a larger campaign. But to begin with, we keep the scope of the conflict contracted. We still keep it. We keep it big and we keep it in like complex, but we won't necessarily want to explore all of that. We want to have a more direct narrative in the beginning. I'm suggesting that as the person with the least agency in terms of narrative, because you guys will be the primary agents of the narrative of this game.
Go us.
I'll just show you a world, and I'll be doing my part on the part of the storyteller, but not the storyteller in this game. This game, it will be the game master. But yeah, this game works around what drives your characters.
Which is also why I consider a longer to be better, so we have time to, you know, get to know our characters.
Definitely. But your characters could also, I mean, this doesn't mean that you are forced to be in a situation where you have to be the ones who make up the narrative. If you want to have your characters get involved in, let's say, a great epic war driven by race and religion, then your characters might, then you might write beliefs for your characters based on this thing you're getting involved with, and as such, the greater narrative of the world could become like a driving framework within which your characters then set the tone for what we see on a scene by scene basis. That's also a thing. So I'm thinking everyone seems to be cool with the idea of going for like a big conflict, but in a non-traditional, we have an evil off switch we can press kind of way.
Mm-hmm.
We also have a Heiner with us now. So,
oh, that's wonderful.
Hello, Your Highness.
Hello, Your Rasmusness.
Hello. you will find in the chat that there's been posted a link to this chronicle.
Okay.
Chronicle? What? I really have the werewolf lingo in my brain right now.
Does it matter though? Couldn't you just call it what you wanted?
It doesn't. I think it's fine, but I'm gonna try anyway. I mean, I have to have my GM stripes from somewhere.
Sure. Yep.
All right, so Heine, we've just talked about what we've done, a basic introduction of what we mean to play and like how this thing is going to work in relation to videos on the channel and so on. But right now we're talking about what we kind of want from the game as a whole, and Chris made a good point about that. I don't know if you want to repeat, Chris, what you suggested for the tone of the campaign.
Basically our heroes are caught up in the events of, say, a war between nations or a big conflict where we can get involved, but our impact on it will not necessarily be world-ending. As Daniel put it, there'll be no kind of off switch for the conflict. Things will progress without us, whether we get involved or not. It's just about choosing how we get involved, whether we pick sides, whether we stay clear and do something else.
Or whether we become profiteers.
Yeah, we've become profiteers. If we work to try and lessen the impact of the war, if we try to make the war worse.
Definitely worse. Definitely worse.
Yeah, basically.
Okay, cool.
I'm all in for seeing how bad we can make it and how quickly a kingdom can fall.
Yikes.
So, yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
All right, so... Yeah, I'm just going to quickly take some notes about that. You, by all means, if you have ideas for what you would want to play and just like stuff floating in your mind that you would like to see if this game can provide you with, just by all means, like throw it out there. I'm just taking notes as we go.
I don't know.
I've already told you, I pretty much have a rough outline of a character that I can probably fit into most games.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think, for my part, I think the douchebag road warden I made for the tests would easily work in with war as a backdrop.
All right.
I think I'll save my test character for another campaign if everyone comes along. Although it would be good for this one, but I want to go with something a bit more... depends. Either someone very, very zealous, or possibly someone who just enjoys fighting.
Yeah.
I feel like this might be a good time to actually share what I've thought of.
Yes.
Fair enough.
I won't hear it.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Go on.
I wanted to make a priest character in almost a kind of cleric kind of sense, of a god for warfare and strategy. So that, I mean, fits quite well.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can definitely see that working. What do you have any... I mean, no, I'm not... I was going to ask, like...
Yes, I have a lot of stuff I could share with you.
What do you want to do with this character? But, I mean, in a nutshell, that is, I guess, partially going to be dictated by where we choose to set this. And I think the word backdrop came up, and I think it's actually relevant to talk about. Where do we want this game to take place in a directly setting-specific kind of way? Like,
okay,
where do we want the game to be in terms of... of what is the aesthetic of the setting we're working with, right? Are we going for late to early medieval Western style? Are we playing ancient Egyptian setting, or are we like what's the tone? Are we geographical aesthetic composition do we want to work with in this game? What culture are we playing with, and what era of technology are we working with?
Okay, so I have a few thoughts on that. As for the setting itself, I have two suggestions. Either we start the game in a town or city near the front. Not at the front, but near the front of the war. So that We can explore basically life in a war, in a city as influenced by war as it would be, or we place the campaign at the front, making the battles and the skirmishes and the combats a central part to the game.
Yeah, I want to quickly interject here. Yep. Because we can definitely set it with war as the tonal backdrop of it. But so far, like the notion has been conflict, which does not necessarily preclude war at all, right? It seems to include the notion of war quite, quite handily. But it doesn't have to be a war if you don't want it to be. You could have any kind of conflict, be it from...
like a plague?
Yeah, you could have disease or socio-political issues or race issues or whatever you want to as a backdrop. You could have, like, we're talking a greater conflict that you can affect that also involve a war if you wanted to.
In this case, the notion of war was mostly a nod to Rasmus's concept, which is a war priest of sorts. I wouldn't mind, say, I don't know, a Salem-ish kind of campaign. Witch trials and the paranoia that comes with witch trials. As far as era and technology, I'll make this short so the others can give some input as well. But one thing I would like to see, it's not a necessity in any way, is basically a 17th century Europe or American colonies thing. It can easily be set in a fantasy setting, that, which is to say not our world, but that kind of that level of technology and architecture and social and cultural backdrops,
like early colonial times, terms of human expansionism and technology and so on.
Yep.
And for those of us who paid zero attention in history, what kind of technological level are we talking?
Guns are a thing. Firearms.
Guns are very much. Yeah, basically, yeah, it's the high point of the transitionary period, and I apologize for using that particular word, of the period where gunpowder warfare became the standard method of combat. At the time, it's a time that's, I think, I've seen referred to casually as the era of pike and shot, because those were the two main means of fighting. You had ranks of pikemen backed up by entire regiments of arquebusiers. Even then, and by the next century, pikemen will have been phased out, but that's the last major fighting method of melee combat. Otherwise, you'd be getting up close and personal on horseback.
I also think a thing such as the industrial era hasn't, if I remember correctly, hasn't quite begun yet. It's still a ways off.
But it is also the period just preceding or leading into the age of sail. So kind of just before the golden age of piracy. But there is some piracy at this point.
I think that could do as a backdrop if you wanted to. There's a lot of elements we can bring up here, like the death of chivalry and so on. Like, these are very, very easy to grasp, very cool, I think, concepts to work with that are kind of contingent on the change in era. Of course, like, the chivalry need not actually be a thing within the world we're designing, but that was a thing that came to my mind.
I could definitely make that work. I will say it's probably a little too high-tech for my personal taste.
Mm-hmm.
Where would you prefer, like, how much would you prefer dialing it back?
Well, if it's just me personally, I would definitely prefer pre-gun era at all. But, again, as you mentioned earlier, it's not just me.
No, but your opinion counts just as much as anyone else. So you have a preference for pre-gunpowder era, sword and lance style of fantasy.
Yeah, that's my personal preference.
I don't mind that. I just don't want the clothes from that time.
No, we can. Luckily, we can make and break and work with whatever facets and elements of this.
This is like, I kind of understand, you know, bows and swords and lances and horses, and you didn't get killed if you weren't fast enough, sort of ish. But the clothing, I hate it. Go die in a corner. Burn it.
It's a very very real thing that this worth noting that. When we talk about eras, we're using a very broad brush here. We might say, oh, so kind of colonial times, but that does not necessarily mean we need to have an America that people are sailing to.
No, no. As far as I was concerned, it was mainly merely the era and the aesthetics of it.
On that part of it, I actually think the whole new continent thing might be interesting.
Mm.
Yeah. But we can just say, no guns, no, go away.
Yeah, but we'll have to, you know, discuss that.
Yeah. So, anyone else? I mean, I see Chris is just be right back, so we'll wait for him to share his opinion on that. But how about you, AJ? Do you have any preference for like, what sort of era and what kind of cultural backdrop you would prefer for the setting?
I've always loved the Victorian styles. And earlier than that, I don't know how early, because so like, in history.
Late Renaissance.
But aesthetics.
Into...
I love the aesthetics up until the Victorian era. After that, it gets really boring for me.
Mm. So not a big fan of industrialization and post-industrialization.
I don't mind it, because steampunk is a thing. It can work. But it's just the clothing they have after that gets really boring, because that's when they go back into, oh, I hate my life, we're dying. And, well,
yeah, I mean, this again, the exact aesthetics of the era is something we can very much make up as we go, right? And it's also not necessarily contingent on what we would consider to be the norm when we think of these things. When we think of, for example, a medieval period, it's very easy for us, being from the area we're from, to think of like the drab mud-colored Hollywood aesthetic of the Dark Ages.
No, when I think about it, I think about little houses pushed together in little streets. It can be quaint, it can be cute, it can be cuddly and everything like that, but I kind of like the idea of the old English gardens where they actually trimmed their hedges.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, yeah. So are we talking like you want to introduce a level of aristocracy and so on into the setting in that regard?
A what? I heard half of it, something went wrong.
I was asking if you would like to introduce the notion of an aristocracy and what impact that social disparity would have on a setting within the story of what we're going to sell.
Yeah.
All right. Just make a note of that. So in terms of era right now, because we have a suggestion of early colonial times, gunpowder weaponry, and pre-gunpowder weaponry. So where do we want to be at in that regard?
Well, I can. It's not like, as I said, it's just my personal preference. I don't think I'd die if that was what we did. So I could certainly go with that. I would probably change my character concept, but as you said, it's not set in stone.
What?
It was just an idea, and I don't necessarily need to use it. So I could definitely work with that, if that is what is decided. What Daniel mentioned before I started talking.
Yeah, I hear nothing from what he's saying right now.
Maybe he should restart.
He's a robot. Open. He's a robot to me.
Sorry for the prolonged absence.
It's all right.
No worries.
What's been discussed? Have we decided the setting?
No, we're still getting there.
I think perhaps we should restart the call if AJ can't hear anything.
Well, I can hear you clearly. I can hear Chris clearly. I can hear Heine clearly.
You need to hear Daniel as well, though.
Hello, AJ. Can you hear what I'm saying?
Hack, hack, cough, cough.
Apparently you can't. She can't.
All right, I'm just going to shut the call down and then host again.
Cool, cool.
Hola.
Hello. Just going to quickly add the others. There we go.
Hello.
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 All right, so let's do a quick audio check here. I see we have AJ in the call. Can you hear me?
Yosh.
Wonderful.
A lot better now.
Cool.
Awesome. So essentially right now, we, in terms of the technology we want to have available within this setting, it's a toss-up right now between early colonialization times.
Mid to late, actually, because it's late 17th century. So.
Oh, right. So mid to late colonial times in that case, which means like a heavy reliance on gunpowder weaponry, shield and plate and so on have basically been outphased and replaced with the musket and the bayonet.
We have someone who would rather not have gotten
we did.
Stuff?
We did. And
that was me, but as I said, I wouldn't die.
I actually preferred without too.
Well, needless to say, I prefer with because that was my suggestion, but...
Alright.
I guess that's why it's a toss-up.
But for my sake, we can easily dial it down. The character concept I have in mind isn't reliant on any kind of firearms. The thing I would prefer not to do, though, is dial it all the way back to the Dark Ages. I would like something a bit more evolved than that.
All right.
It doesn't have to be entirely historical. We can combine elements of the
two. And that was what I was about to say. We can easily combine the aesthetics of, let's say, the late 17th century and just provide some in-game reason for there not being any... for firearms not being widespread.
Yeah, I mean, this is a framework in which we can work with whatever we want, right? We could have it be, I mean, we've only really talked about, era in terms of weaponry, but there's also other things to consider, right? We could go back as far or be in a culture that doesn't have human written word. Mm. We could do that. We can go as long a ways as we want forward, as long as we stay within what we can, like, foreseeably work with the setting. We could have, like, we could have culverine guns pointing out of ancient Sumerian buildings for all we want, right? We could work with the aesthetic and the culture however we want. So maybe I mean, if we're presently, like, kind of working in a between sword and shield and sword and shield being outphased in favor of gunpowder. Maybe we strike somewhere in the middle where we have like a recent introduction of gunpowder weaponry, but we still have the sword and sorcery feel of a more rooted in classic medieval fantasy trope-ish setting. Like a setting technologically comparable to, for example, what we see in Pillars of Eternity, where it's very much classical fantasy, but somewhere out there, someone figured out that this black powder can propel small pellets of lead at high velocity and kill stuff at great distance. And the cultural shifts that might occur as a result of that. I mean, that could even be the backdrop of the conflict we're talking about, right? Someone out there has found out that you can use gunpowder, and now all of a sudden the world's in turmoil because some people have it and some people don't.
Like when they got the A-bomb?
Yeah, but on the...
Oh no, we need the A-bomb too! Oh no, you can kill us!
The race
I think in that regard, I've don't think I'd actually mind going a little closer to, you know, sword and shield being close to being outphased, as long as they're not completely outphased already, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
It certainly does, because there was actually a period historically where those two things, I won't say coexisted, but they were both there in terms of warfare.
Yeah.
And it makes, as Daniel suggested, it kind of does make sense. Let's say one nation has invented gunpowder, and clearly it's superior to anything else. Well, what does that nation do?
To a point, I mean, gunpowder weapons of the time, of course, were... They had their issues. So they were game changer, but they're not. They weren't the end-all and be-all, because if they were the end-all and be-all, then... The armies of the world would have adopted gunpowder weapons a lot quicker.
In this setting, there's also another factor we have to take into account, which would be the prevalence of magic.
Exactly. I mean, if you've got magic armor, that could stop a bullet dead in its tracks.
Yeah, and I mean, early gunpowder weapons didn't have that long range. If you could throw a fireball at much longer range, then it wouldn't be as efficient. So that's probably something we should talk about.
Yeah, I think so too. Let's talk about the fantasy aspects of this, like how high or how dark of a fantasy do we want to go with here? And we can kind of make and break elements and rearrange them if you want to. So do we want magic to be prevalent in the world? Do we want there to be magic at all? Do we want there to be a magic, but it's very rare? Where do we want to be at that?
I'm fine with anything but doesn't exist. That's the one I would be very sad to go with. All the others I'd be fine with.
Yeah, I agree with Rasmus. I would be very sad if magic wasn't a thing. That said, one thing I would like to explore is the notion of a low magic setting. It definitely exists. We have witches, we have warlocks, we have priests who can perform miracles and so on. But
wicked monsters in the countryside.
Yep. And yeah. but at a relatively low level. It's not a deal breaker in any way. If people would rather have lots of magic and Pathfinder level magic, then I'm fine with that as well.
I think I'd actually prefer low levels of magic and perhaps very dangerous, because nobody knows a lot about it.
So magic that corrupts.
Yeah.
It's interesting this is being brought up, because this gives me an opportunity to quickly have the system we're working with give us something, like give us some boundaries with that we can kind of push against. If we're using the game, and we are, right, but as well as we're able, we're playing this by the book, because I'm not really up for hacking the game on my first go. That means magic is dangerous. There is no way we can construct this in which magic is not supremely scary.
Unless we're all elves.
I guess so. But human magics, I guess. I should clarify that human magic, sorcery as it is scary. The simplest attempt at magic can go catastrophically wrong if you fuck it up severely enough. So that is definitely there. The question, of course, is now the prevalence of it. And, I mean, is everyone fine with the notion of it being, on the low end? Like, it definitely exists, but it's not prevalent. It's not, come to the adventure mod, we have potions, but it's something in, like...
Like, find the secret witch in the cavern, more likely.
I dig it.
I prefer that.
Oh, yeah, so... So Chris, what we talked about was the prevalence of magic.
Is it prevalent?
Well, that's what
the notion so far from Hein and me was that it's kind of rare, not well understood, and incredibly dangerous if it fucks up.
So basically, like, magic has always been proclaimed to be in history.
Yep.
Yeah, kind of, I guess.
We kind of have, like, the first place my mind wandered at this was The Witcher.
Yeah,
I can see that.
Haven't played it.
in a nutshell, magic definitely exists, and sorcery and sorcerers and warlocks and so on, that's a thing. But it is also rare enough that it's not culturally accepted within most polite society in within the setting of the game.
Magic's a myth in most societies, or what?
What?
Magic's a myth in most societies, or
no? It's an accepted reality. You just don't like it.
Oh. Yeah. So yeah, the average I don't like you because you've got more power than me. There have been several in the world of the Witcher. There have been several purges, riots, and pogroms against magic users, among other people.
Also, Witchers, because they also knew stuff like that.
Well, they're mutants as well.
And there were mutants, yeah, and they played with demons and stuff. They didn't understand either, so they had to be killed.
Sounds fun. Right. I could work with that, definitely.
Yeah. I'm not saying let's borrow everything from The Witcher and make magic outlawed and constantly hunted. We could do that. I was referencing The Witcher in regards to like the scarcity of it, right? Everyone kind of accepts that it's there, but not everyone knows a sorcerer.
Yeah, no. And I think maybe we should consider the fact that perhaps elven or dwarven magic is much more accepted because it's safer and more. Well, I mean, dwarven magic is basically crafting, right?
That's a good point, and let's use that as to segue into the next point, which is the prevalence of the fantasy races. We could make a setting that is entirely human stock. We could have elves and dwarves, or just dwarves, or whatever. We could like, what races do we want to work with?
Well, I would prefer for them all to be there, but perhaps we could go with, they're all there, just mostly humans, or, I mean, near extinct dwarves and elves, or something like that.
That could
work. If we want to go with magic is not very prevalent, and they have, you know, this different sort of magic, then perhaps they're not very prevalent either.
Or they just keep to themselves because humans have a tendency to fuck everything up.
True.
Is there anyone who objects to the other races primarily being elves, dwarves, and orcs existing in the world?
Oh yeah, orcs are existing too.
Yeah, I should probably add that the existence of orcs, orcs are not, I mean, we can make of them however, whatever we want, but they... Orcs are very angry. Let's just put it like that.
Orcs are werewolves.
And they have a lot of hatred and a lot of very... Like, they have a destructive streak about them. But we can still... put our minds together. We could make it work that orcs also exist within parts of society. But it's easier, in my opinion, to have orcs be on the outskirts of society, maybe being an enemy who's attacking inwards, than it is for us to have, like, the orc quarter of town. It could work, but just need some tinkering.
I mean, we could work with that perhaps as a backdrop for racial conflict if we want it.
Mm. Wouldn't it be great, considering the origin of where we get orcs from, if that was actually an inversion, where an orc isn't actually... a hideous green rage monster or a corrupted fallen elf, but was actually something like the orcs could almost be the word they use for half-breeds, like half-human, half-elf, or half-dwarf, half-elf, or something, because it's a corruption.
That's pretty wicked.
That sounds cool.
Just a suggestion, but yeah.
The strength of a dwarf and the size of a human?
Yeah, or somewhere in between, yeah. Or maybe, all of the sort of social/physical weaknesses of a dwarf in a human who happens to have some very basic rudimentary access to dwarven magic. Or something.
Orcs have their own stuff?
Orcs have their own life paths, let's be clear here. There is some... When we talk about the mix of magic and the mix of the races, the Burning Wheel as a system very much diversifies the cultural, biological, and the existential importance of the separate races in a way that is very dissimilar, for example, from what you have in Pathfinder, where you could have a half-orc wizard and an elven wizard in Pathfinder essentially being the same thing, and whatever you then choose to make different between them is entirely up to you and what brush you use to add flavor. That is not the case for this game. Elves have their own life paths, orcs have their own life paths, and dwarves have their own life paths, and humans have their own life paths. They are creatures not really on an existential level capable of overlapping, right? The elves are Tolkien-esque elves. You won't catch one of them making barrels in a shitty quarter of a human city. Not unless we explicitly changes the system to make that work.
I had an idea, actually.
Yeah.
Because this was something that was mentioned earlier. The possibility of there being the new world. Not necessarily us, you know, exploring it, but perhaps orcs have only recently been discovered and they live on the new world.
That's actually really cool. I like that. What do you guys think?
I didn't hear it.
Rasmus, would you repeat for AJ's sake?
I'm going to finish chilling.
Okay, I am completely with that one.
Yeah, basically the idea is that the orcs would be the stand-in for the natives of the new world. So basically they'd be like the Native Americans or the Mesoamericans or something.
Are you telling us that we're supposed to wipe out orcs?
No, as
I said, we don't necessarily have to even be on the new continent, but perhaps they were just discovered over there. And that's where they are.
Couldn't it be fun if that's where we found the dwarves and elves too? It's an entirely new place with completely other natives.
So basically, what would happen if the humans of in real life in Europe had sailed to the Americas and instead discovered Middle Earth?
No, I'm thinking we have this. We just found the new world. There's orcs, but then there's the island over here that's full of mountains and that's dwarves. So that the base people on that place have gone in different places. You know, evolution changed them into different things.
Perhaps so, then it would make sense to have a more even divide. So perhaps in the old world it's humans and elves, and in the new world it's dwarves and orcs.
Something like that. Or it's four different continents and four different people. And because Possibly. It's the new worlds where we just started to look around, we're finally finding out that they're there.
That could work. We could also, we talk about new continents, and I guess that could still work. We don't actually have to, if we want to make a new world story, we don't have to have it be that discoverers, explorers sailed there. It could be anything else. We could have, maybe on the let's say we have human land, insert generic human land, and that which is the primary backdrop for the human stock of the setting as we know it, and maybe a ways to the north of that place there was this area you couldn't generally travel because there was a fucking storm there, and the area is basically just called the storm, and every now and again a different culture would emerge from there. Maybe there's a fantasy Vietnamese civilization within the mountains of the perpetual storm area who live in eternal rainfall and lightning, and they have wicked and ancient magics and are very spooky and scary. And just recently they opened the doors to human land and allowed explorers to pass through the storm and into the new world, which then turned out to have a lot of forgotten creatures of lore that humankind had maybe all but accepted didn't exist.
So basically, we're after Middle-earth have finally gotten rid of all the dwarves and all the elves that have left. And then we go out and find them again.
That could be it. What
would the great conflict be then, if you wanted something like that?
The reintroduction of humanity into the reintroduction of the fantastical races into the lives of humans, or the human expansion into those worlds.
I think generally, well, not generally, historically speaking, the colonization of the New World was filled with conflicts, as the white man, in this case the Europeans, wouldn't play ball with the natives.
Mm.
In that case, might I suggest something?
Yeah, sure.
Because if we're just going in there to look, I mean, sure, it's bound to bring a few conflicts. But what if the ancient Vietnamese mages suddenly disappeared and took the storm with them, and now we're trying to take over the land left behind? I mean, that would be more of a, well, now we're kind of invading, which would probably create more hostilities.
So kind of like everyone making a mad dash for El Dorado setting?
Yeah, pretty much.
So basically, it's like playing Civilization with a big landmass in the middle, and now we're fighting to get there first.
Yeah.
We could definitely work with that if you want to. Alternatively, I kind of want to make this idea, I want to put this idea out there also, because I just realized that I did a thing. Sometimes mm-hmm. I do a thing, but I realized that I did a thing. And that thing was, I immediately defaulted to the human expansionism, because humans are prevalent and humans are adaptable and humans this and humans that, and humans go out there and stick their toes in everything, because that is a well used, very good trope of fantasy and real world history for that matter. Yeah. But that is also like the assumed default, basically. What if we turned that on its head? What if we subverted that and maybe the gates into the, let's go with the storm still, like, we could do anything, right? But the gates to the new world opened, and elves invaded humanity.
Oh, like, so maybe, we're being invaded.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, like, that could totally work.
Maybe we subvert that. Maybe the dwarven kings are herding their armies of orcs towards humanity in an attempt to eradicate this new pestilent race that has emerged on their doorstep.
In that case, because I really like that idea, perhaps we should have two of them being allies with a third one being kind of neutral to have options.
Yeah. I mean, does this sit well with everyone? Because we can figure out the details of it if people totally like the overall idea.
Yeah, I'm good with that.
Humans have always been good at cultivating fixing stuff so they have plenty of food. They could totally see that. Oh, I want that. You yeah. know how to do shit like that. You have fertile lands. We want that.
There's a scenario.
Go away. We are the natives. We are the Indians. Run!
You bring that up, AJ, but there's a scenario in history I got described to me once. I forget what it's called, but it's basically like an area of speculative study. That is, what if the Aztecs invaded Europe? I forget what it's called, but it's basically like that idea.
Mm.
Yeah.
And this kind of feels like that. Sorry, Heide, you had a point. Please go on.
I did?
Yeah, you were about to raise your voice, and I wanted to quickly interject in regards to what
I was just about to say that it's basically alien invasion fantasy style.
Yeah,
pretty much.
Lol.
I like it.
Anything with that?
Yeah. I kind of like the idea, and they come in with their longbows and shit, and we just barely realize there's something called guns.
Yeah, that's really it. That's why it's so unfair, right? That's why this is a battle. That's why this is a pitched battle, because you just discovered gunpowder technology, and you're feeling pretty good about that. You've kind of sort of maybe unified a big part of what constituted human lands before, and maybe there are still like some continent and fringe cultures, of course, as there always are, but for most parts, humanity is kind of seeing this beginning of a renaissance, and then suddenly there's this new element, and you're firing your brand new guns at it, and oh, what the fuck? What are these things? Like, you're shooting your gun at dwarven plate, and it doesn't work.
And here and here comes the fucking idiots with their magic, and it doesn't work. Help!
That sounds cool.
Yeah. That could also be why magic is very new to humans. They've never actually seen it before, so they had guns because they couldn't make big boom booms with their fingers.
They either it's only just discovered it, or as is often common, they had it, but they just called it faith.
It could have been forgotten.
It could have been. It might be. It might be that. I mean, to go back to the idea of quote unquote the storm. Maybe magic used to be prevalent until that thing happened, and now people
it's
don't.
Resurging?
People don't go to and from the storm because it's dangerous, and you get struck by lightning and crushed by avalanches and drowned in floodings. But now, because things have changed somehow,
maybe the storm disappeared, so they could suddenly leave the place.
Yeah, something to that effect, at least, right? People, what little magic there was someone kind of wandering out of the storm. And being like very creepy and like magic is very strange because it belongs to this like
the storm.
Creature of the area of badness.
It kind of reminds me a little of Mad Max, that big wall of storm that encircles the entire area.
Yeah.
So what now that the storm is gone? Is magic also experiencing a renaissance or at least an increase in power or?
We might have seen magic start making its way out there. I like maybe magic is
because if it is, I could totally work with making like a Morrigan type character who has lived in the outlands near the storm or something.
That would be really cool, actually. Yeah, I like this. Let's.
I was kind of thinking that we could make sisters.
Totes.
Even better, twins.
Just to go with the classic.
Yep.
Well, I'd be up for that.
Maybe the reason this is introducing a dilemma into human society is that it has always been accepted that magic exists. And we have had, like, people coming. People do train in magic, and every now and again, someone wanders out of the storm and has, like, this new and weird magic from beyond the sheet of rain. And those people are, of course, universally mistrusted or universally prized or whatever. Like, people treat them differently because they're from this very strange place. But with
what about a mixture of both? Distrusted, yeah. But, you know, revered for what they can do.
That might be the case. But then with the reintroduction into society of more magic, not a lot of magic, it's not that prevalent, but there is more of it. That maybe then comes to be at odds with the faith of humans, which is traditionally among humankind been where you go to get shit done that you can't do with mundane means. Mm-hmm. Because suddenly there is this cast of like this group of people who are now kind of infringing on the world of the gods.
Hmm. That would be cool.
All right. So, I mean, we don't have to attend, address all the little details, but I like that. So
what we have so far is we lived in human lands. Magic was scarce because most of it was kept by the storm. Now the storm is gone and we're being invaded, and the people who were closest to the storm are probably, I know, fleeing towards more civilized places and bringing with them, well,
what they've
magic.
Learned by living near the storm.
Which in turn infringes on the whole, on the realm of the divine.
And that they don't like because they see the people that comes out of the storm invading them has the same kind of shit, so they're probably working for them.
How does that sound to everyone? I like it, at least.
Hmm. Alright. Alright, so we have a general framework of an idea now with which we can sort of start to create a world and create characters within that space, and we can flesh out the details as we go, and we can flesh out the details, like more details between now and actual play session and so on.
I'm going to mute for a few minutes.
Alright, so I was thinking, what are we going for in terms of how does things look? Is this a European setting? Or is this gunpowder weaponry and colonialism, but like in a backdrop of ancient China? Or what are we looking at here? Are we thinking thatched huts and lots of grasslands? Or are we thinking wetlands or lots of plateaus? Or human culture is maybe Norse? Or like we don't necessarily be limited to let's boilerplate an existing human culture, right? But I'm trying to kind of toss up the idea that what are we going for here? What is the human backdrop?
My personal preference would be the I keep going back to it, but the late 17th century Europe. It doesn't have to be Western Europe, but that style.
All right, so we're talking timber frame and chalk houses starting to overtake stone buildings and so on.
Yep.
All right, and yeah.
I'm all in for that.
So from this, I garner an overall Western aesthetic.
Mm. Mm-hmm.